Good morning. Welcome to the Little Home Church by the Wayside. This is the 16th Sunday after Pentecost. We welcome everyone this morning, including those watching online from near and far. We are an open and affirming church. Folks from all walks of life, regardless of race, sexuality, or any other perceived differences, are welcome here at our church and always will find a place at our table. You are important to us. Please fill out a visitor's card. There is no fellowship hour today due to the rummage sale. There's just no room in the inn, as it were. But it is kind of a nice day outside. So as we did when we first started meeting again, you know, with the pandemic and COVID, if you want to hang out outside, we've got all of those benches that Charles Karwowski built for us years ago. Hang out. It's a nice, so the flowers today are provided by Mary Budzinski. We want to thank Anne for being our PA. Again, always think about signing up to be an usher, a PA, or helping us with fellowship in the parish hall. For this week, any pastoral emergencies, call my cell phone. It's there listed in the bulletin. And there are only, you know those three important words in real estate: location, location, location. Well, in the life of the Little Home Church this week, there are only two words: rummage sale, rummage sale, rummage sale. So I know that Lori sent out an email this week about the rummage sale, and if you would, just send that on to your friends. It's really, really important that you do that. And I know Mary Roach is in the back there. She's ushering today. Do you want to give us some instructions on rummage sale this week, Mary?
Sure. Furniture, you have to send me a picture. Please send me. So, anyway, please, if you're donating furniture, send me a picture first. It really needs to be like new or white new. Yeah. And we're taking kids' clothes. We don't have a lot of kids closed yet. We don't have a lot of kids closed yet, so we're going up to grammar school on that. And we'll say adult schools as well, but they, again, need to be new or light new. No electronics, no books, but it's really fun. So anybody who wants to come by and help this week, that's great. We need cashiers for Thursday night, Friday, and Saturday morning. So thank you. Yay. Thanks, Susie.
All right. Mary, thank you so much. And I really have to say that I'm here every day of the week, it seems. But Mary has been here and just doing an incredible job. And there have been so many others who have stepped in to help with the rummage sale. And so so please, wherever you can fit in this week, and if you still have rummage sale, I think up until Wednesday, you can drop some things by. All right, after the rummage sale, next weekend, we have another very important event in the life of the community in our church. And we have some visitors here today, so this will be something you really don't want to miss for next week. Next Sunday, October 2nd, is Blessing of the Hounds. We'll have an abbreviated service here. We'll start at 9:30, end by 10:15. And next week is Worldwide Communion as well, where we celebrate communion with everyone around the world in all ways and forms. And so children will stay in church. There'll be no Sunday school next week. And we'll have this abbreviated service. And then we'll go out to the front of the church on the steps. And we'll do this wonderful service that is my understanding, Wayne and Laurel, you guys founded this event. And so thank you for it, because it's such a lovely tradition. And we will bless the horses and the hounds and the riders and the imaginary fox, and it's just a wonderful, wonderful community event. There'll be refreshments outside as well, and so you don't want to miss it. Now, something connected to this year for us, we received an invitation to attend the DuPage Hunt Breakfast at the Dunham Woods Riding Club afterwards. It is a fundraiser for them, so the breakfast is $65. It starts around 1 o'clock, so there's plenty of time to do Blessing of the Hounds, and if you go, maybe you can help us clean up afterwards a little bit before we go down there. The cost is $65. I need to know really by today. So again, you can text me on my cell, send me an email, but if you'd like to go, it would be great for our church. I think we have 4 people so far signed up, but they have asked for us to have a presence at the DuPage Hunt Breakfast next week after words at Dunham Woods Riding Club. So let me know if you can do that. We've also been asked to provide for another refugee family, and I believe that all of the tangible items are taken. And so the one thing we can still do are some cash offerings, which will help us to do the grocery shopping and buy the bedding at the last minute when we find out what family we have. I think that's it. Are there any other announcements anybody has this morning? Oh, I forgot this. So for the Blessing of the Hounds this coming week, with that reception out front, if you can bake some cookies, buy some cookies, whatever you can do to help so that we have a lot of refreshments for all of our guests next week who will be here, that would be a great thing to do as well. Yes, one more. Catherine. Thank you. Anyone else?
Laurel,
okay, so thank you, Laurel. So parking. The Wayne police have been alerted from the hunt as well. The 100 yards in front of the church on both the north and the south side of Army Trail, we will leave vacant. So when the horses and the hounds come up, we have the service. We don't have any cars real close to the horses. So try to think of that. I believe there'll be some blockades next week for that. But just in your mind, try to keep 100 yards from the church either way when you park next week. There's plenty of parking around at the school and just farther down for that day. Thank you for that. Anybody else? But we have addressed that with the police station and things then. All right. So for just a second, I'm going to ask you to close your eyes. Take a few deep breaths. And to center on this time that we have together to worship, to pray. To pray for ourselves, to pray for others, to invite the Spirit of God into our lives. Ask a special blessing on someone you just noticed when you walked in the church this morning. You don't need to know their name or anything about them, but they're just in your heart and in your mind right now. May we experience the love of God through the singing of our songs, our prayers, our words, the light of Christ carried in, symbolized in the candles, and that we will carry out at the end of the service. Amen.
Ask you to stand for the call to worship. Come to this place and time of promise.
We are inhabiting the house of hope, the field of sunflowers, the vineyard of great glory.
Come to a shared commitment to abundance possible for all people.
We are an earthenware jar to keep safe the tomorrow.
The word of God, and our password is love. Join me in the prayer of invocation. God, we give you thanks that you make us redeemers, not just receivers of redemption. You bring us among friends and ask for each one of our signatures to change your world. We hold the earthenware jar you call the church and fill it with all your promises. Amen. Kindly join me in the prayer of transformation and new life. God, I have defaulted to unhope in my life, and I have encouraged unhoping in others. I have criticized plans before hearing them out, and I have turned to family, church, friends, colleagues, with my face painted, "We've tried that before, and it didn't work." Together, we have laughed at new ideas and circulated only bad ones. Plant your promises deep in the fields of our lives and forgive us our presuming to define your future. Amen. Hear these words of grace. God wipes pessimism from the open heart and sends others to affirm in us even the most fragile possibilities of the future. We are forgiven.
Sing to the Lord of harvest, sing songs of love and praise.
With joyful hearted voices, your Alleluia's praise.
In God the rolling seasons, in steadfast honor move.
Sing to the Lord.
May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
We encourage placing your hands on your heart as you greet those around you.
How are you today? Ooh, good, good. Why do I have a pot? Well, because it goes with the Bible lesson today a little bit. So I'm going to share some things with you about what the adults are going to, a story the adults are going to study. Anne is going to read for us in just a little bit. And so what it is it goes back to that prophet Jeremiah from the Old Testament. And the story goes like this. The people of Jerusalem, they weren't behaving very well. And so there were these other people who decided they were going to take over their country. A little bit, does anybody have a sense of what's going on in the world right now? Is there any place else like that? Where? Ukraine and Russia, just a little bit. And Aaron, did you want to add to that? Okay, so even in India, there's a portion of India that's trying to separate from itself. Thank you for that lesson. I appreciate it. So here's the thing. Jeremiah, this prophet, he's actually in the capital. He's in the city. And that's oftentimes where they're going to try to overthrow something. And couldn't you just imagine, like, people in Ukraine and in Indian things, that how scary that would be, you know, just to be in that place where somebody's going to overtake. And in the midst of all of that, God says to Jeremiah, hey, I need you to make a land deal. And Jeremiah's like, God, you know, please, we're really, you know, we're under some pressure here right now. You know, can't you, you know, can't you help us out here? And what God asked Jeremiah to do is to buy a piece of property, because it's a symbol of hope for the future. And what's going to happen in Jerusalem is going to happen. And there's going to be a period of waiting for them then. They are going to be overthrown. But when God asked Jeremiah to do this land deal, the symbolism, the meaning of it is that eventually they're going to get the land back. And it's going to be a place of peace and prosperity. And it gives them hope for the future. And some of the people aren't going to see the future with that, but they're going to know that it happened. So they signed these real estate papers. Aaron, I'm thinking of your mom, Heather, and Mr. Mark in the back there today. People know a lot about real estate in this room, and probably many people have signed real estate papers. And they put it in an earthen jar, and it's kept there for 70 years. This is a pot, but it's the best I could do. All right? That was just the time limit of the contract. And contracts have limits on them. And so what it did was it gave them a future and a hope to know that they weren't going to be prisoners forever. They just would have to wait it out. Have you ever had to wait for some things in your life? Yeah. It's tough sometimes. Mm-hmm. Do timeouts sometimes seem... Oh, oh yeah. Okay, so timeouts can seem really long. But you always have the hope at the end that the timeout ends and that it's going to be okay and you're forgiven from your timeout. So this morning, you are also going to do some things to give some people a future and a hope. Things are very expensive to buy sometimes, and we have a church rummage sale going on. And you guys, your Sunday school lesson today is actually something we've never done, I don't think, in Sunday school before. But you guys are going to help with the Sunday school back there. You're going to do some things to help the rummage sale happen this week for people who need some of those products. And it's really important to help other people. Clara, You're going to be making signs for the rummage sale. Right. Mrs. Leswing and Dr. Brito are going to be back there to help you with that. And it's really good to help other people out as well, because maybe they've been waiting for a long time for certain things. And so we really appreciate everybody helping each other out with this morning. So keep that in mind, that sometimes we have to wait for things, but there's always hope. You guys are the hope of our church for the future. And that it's really important to always help others out in any way we can. So before you go, can you guys get us started in the Lord's Prayer? Okay, here we go. Nice loud voices. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So Warren, can I trust you with this? Will you take that back? And they'll know where to put that in the rummage sale. So you guys head on back that way. And Genevieve, you wanna go back with moms? Do you wanna go back with mom? She's gonna go, she stays with her moms. So continuing in that frame of mind of prayer, I have been asked to announce several prayer requests, and then we certainly want to hear from you as well. There are others. I want to celebrate with Ron and Diane Dipner, who welcomed a new grandchild into their family in the last week. Lori and I visited Ron on Thursday, and Ron is... we do have visitors here today. Ron is our former pastor, retired pastor emeritus, and it looks like October 1st he'll be able to come home. So fingers crossed for that. Ruth, I talked to earlier this week. She was in Del Nor with COVID. I don't know if she's returned home yet or not, but there was a prayer request that went out. She's in room 205 if she's still in Del Nor. So keep Ruth in our prayers. And then we want to keep Jenny Sweeney in our prayers. Kit texted this morning that Jenny is still suffering from shingles, so we want to keep her in our prayers. 18-year-old Carly Zalatis got all clear biopsies on her most recent tests for her, and so that's really good news. Dan Wolf, Samantha's boyfriend, also received good news on his tests. He had to have a surgery delayed because some things weren't quite right, but now test results are coming out good, and that's great news. Lori is not here this morning. She sent a text to me this morning. Steve's brother, Doug, who's been suffering from cancer, is in ICU with pneumonia and sepsis, and so we want to hold the praying family in our prayers. One of our new members, Brian Martoszowski, who couldn't be here this morning, asked for prayers for the Dave LoBianco family. Dave's son Michael, who's in his 40s, was killed in Switzerland this week where he lives. And so we want to keep that family in our prayers as well. Are there others? Grace. And here comes the microphone.
Hello. I just would ask prayers for my youngest son, Ian, who's going through a huge life change right now. He had expected and invested in a business that he was to start, and things didn't work out, and he's stepped away from that, and so has a lot of changes coming up in his life, and just asking for his strength and wisdom and courage of spirit.
And I'll share a joy. It's great to have Nick here on your first Sunday. Thank you so much. It's great to hear the organ. Oh, and to have our guest flautist, Chanel, here today. Thank you. Anyone else? Let's pray. Good and gracious God, there is no part of life you do not touch. You are there in all parts of our lives. What we see as the good, or the bad, or the ugly, we don't always want you to see the things as they really are. Help us to know your love, to let you in, drawing us out and lifting us up, wrapping us in your love until our defenses are lowered, our barriers broken down, and the power of your love reveals the beauty you intended for us, for all of your children. May our actions draw attention to you, to the richness you bring to all life, and the abundance you share, setting the scene for us to share as well. Help us to bring light into all the darkness of life, spreading hope for a better world, a world where justice is made real by your children living together in harmony. Help us to bring salt into the blandness of life, encouraging vitality and joy in living, and a world that dares to hope for the future that you promise, where all your children will know themselves loved and valued and treasured, created in your image, bringing you glory forever. God, we thank you for new life. We thank you for healing, for Ron, for Dan. Be with Ruth and Ginny and Carly. Be with Doug. May they feel your presence. Be with Ian as he transitions through another phase of life. Be with the Lo Bianco family as they mourn the loss of the tragic death of their son, Michael. And God, be with all of the requests that are silent this morning, that haven't been named out loud. We pray all this knowing, good God, you are hearing us far better than we are speaking. And we offer these prayers in all the holy names of God. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is from the Old Testament, the book of Jeremiah, chapter 32, verses 1 through 3a and 6 through 15. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord in the 10th year of King Zedekiah of Judah, which was the 18th year of Nebuchadnezzar. At that time, the army of the king of Babylon was besieging Jerusalem, and the prophet Jeremiah was confined in the court of the guard that was in the palace of the king of Judah, where King Zedekiah of Judah had confined him. Jeremiah said, "The word of the Lord came to me. Hanamel, son of your uncle Shalom, is going to come to you and say, 'Buy my field that is at Anathoth, for the right of redemption by purchase is yours.' Then my cousin Hanamel came to me in the court of the guard, in accordance with the word of the Lord, and said to me, 'Buy my field that is at Anathoth in the land of Benjamin, for the right of possession and redemption is yours. Buy it for yourself.' Then I knew that this was the word of the Lord. And I bought the field at Anathoth from my cousin, Hanamel, and weighed out the money to him, 17 shekels of silver. I signed the deed, sealed it, got witnesses, weighed the money on scales. And then I took the sealed deed of purchase, containing the terms and conditions, and the open copy. And I gave the deed of purchase to Baruch, son of Neriah, son of Micaiah, in the presence of my cousin Hanamel, in the presence of witnesses who signed the deed of purchase, and in the presence of all Judeans who were sitting in the court of the guard. In their presence, I charged Baruch, saying, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, take these deeds, both the sealed deed of purchase and this open deed, and put them in an earthenware jar in order that they may last for a long time. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, houses and fields and vineyards shall again be bought in this land." For the word of Scripture, for the word among us, for the word within us. Thanks be to God.
Well, that was a mouthful. Well done. The PA almost needed to be a paralegal to read that this morning. And it's actually a really inspiring passage in the Bible. And we're going to take a look at it today and see what we can learn from this. Have you ever felt like absolutely everything was falling apart around you? Maybe even working against you? Not everyone else, just you experiencing this, that you are literally living in crisis mode. Reactive mode takes over. There's not even capacity to hope. Well, welcome to Jeremiah's day. Remember last week we learned Jeremiah was often called the crying prophet. Jeremiah is full of trauma and drama, and today's story is no exception. If you identified with any of my opening questions, then Jeremiah would have said, "Honey, pull up a chair and sit next to me." Here it is in a nutshell. The Babylonians are attacking and taking over Jerusalem, and the people are hearing this, who have misbehaved once again, and they will be living under exile. Considering that the Babylonians were attempting to topple an independent nation, the king's palace would have been the prime target. Jeremiah is imprisoned within the target. That's the position he finds himself in during what is really the most stressful event of his lifetime. So during the siege, while the city of Jerusalem was being taken, God, the sovereign one, taps Jeremiah on the shoulder and asks him to make a real estate deal. It's a deal between family, and it provides a vision for a brighter future. In the midst of the siege of Jerusalem and the certainty of Jerusalem's defeat, Jeremiah is commanded to buy a piece of land, a seemingly pointless thing to do. In his explanation, God makes it clear that nothing is impossible for him. He is the God who creates and saves by his great power. In the midst of threatening disaster, a message of hope is given. This is not the end. Judgment has to come, but through it all, God will bring about a new beginning. Jeremiah's symbolic action enacts God's promises in a vivid way. His piece of land is a deposit of what is to come, a land of peace, a land of prosperity, under God's guidance. Even more important is the restored covenant relationship between God and the people. Theologian Hedy Lallman put it this way: the command paints a vision, but it is not one of victory over an enemy. It's an assurance of existence. The specificity of the command seems incongruous with the moment. Is every little detail of this future transaction really necessary while the surrounding city is bombarded by the advancing Babylonians? If there was to be a word of hope, why would it come by this very unusual way? Perhaps all of the detail is the point, It makes the message of hope concrete in the face of present terror and impending defeat. The progression of actions within the overall command command do not signal any extraordinary process. This transfer is not dependent upon a miracle. In fact, it is a routine transaction. Routines can be grounding. They offer stability and reassurance. Imagine being in the midst of a catastrophic event, and imagine even just a portion of life being normal during that time. The nature of the transaction is also significant. A land transfer, occupation, and exile in the present is not the final status. The covenant transfers, renews, and ensures a new age. It would be customary to have two copies, one completely sealed and one partially sealed, both that which was sealed and that which was open. We are left to conjecture why there were two documents and why one was sealed and the other open. Anne was in my office last night after doing some rummage sale work and questioned the reading she was going to read today. Possibly, as in modern transactions, one was simply a duplicate copy of the other, the sealed document being the formal evidence of purchase kept by the buyer, and the other left with the vendor for reference. The more probable explanation, however, is that the unsealed document, which the witnesses did not subscribe or see, contained details which did not concern the witnesses. The price paid, the conditions of resumption by the vendor, possibly some reference to the period of 70 years at which, at the end and not before, the heirs of Jeremiah might expect to enter on possession. In this case, both copies are placed in an earthenware jar for safekeeping. Remember a few weeks ago, as we've been studying Jeremiah, he was instructed to go down and watch a potter at his wheel, making a vessel. Hope is in the jar of clay made by the potter's hands for use according to the potter's plans. So how does this apply to us? Last Friday, I spent the entire morning on a Zoom for an educational TPIRC summit. Professor Cameron Trimble presented a lecture and discussion on the future of spirituality. I'd like to share a few highlights from it, and you will also find these in my By the Way article this month. By the Way is our little home church. By the Wayside is our monthly newsletter. So she started by stating something pretty obvious, and that was that the world and the church had changed after going through a pandemic. And she asked this question: what would the church look like in 2070? Having just celebrated 150 years, and coming up on the month of October, it will be 151, we might think not much different. When we look at this beautiful sanctuary that was restored, we might not think it was very different. But this sanctuary, this is only the building. Go back to your Sunday school days and think of that song. I am the church, you are the church. We are the church together. We have changed. Last week, in a discussion about this with a friend of mine who's a clergy, she said a good way to frame it might be, what did the church look like and what did we look like 50 years ago? And when you think about that, the church has changed significantly, just like the world around it. Is the church stagnant? If so, why would we want to remain stagnant? If transformation is needed, what and who will be the eyes and ears for transformation? For a long time, we've told a story of power over God in the sky, rather than power with God with us. The old hierarchy no longer works. It just might be time to craft a new story. Here were a few things that were suggested the church might become. A few will sound familiar, which I was kind of proud of for the little home church. A place of contemplation. More inclusive, more collaborative. An eco-civilization, focusing more on sustainability and sacred balance. Our kids' whole year is focused on creation and taking care of God's earth. The church can be more pluralistic, a place where everyone belongs, and more interdependent, where everything belongs. Let's not live in a poverty of imagination. We need to craft tomorrow. What do we need to carry forward to the future? And what do we need to leave behind? Let's begin to think of the congregation as an amazing school of love. Here are some questions I'll ask, and they are repeated in By the Way. When you think of your connection to the church, and specifically the little home church, what are you in it for? What are you not in it for? How do you wish to belong and experience belonging? What experiences do you crave that grow your spirit? What can you be counted on for? What promise can you make to the rest of us? This was a scary one, particularly for someone who's grown up in the church and is so focused on worship all my life. Are congregations old technology, or will they be? How else can we or might we connect and act together? So, and by the way, I've asked you to send me emails to those answers. You'll see the questions. And I think I'll report back if I get some answers. When you answer, know that the best gift you can give is to be honest. The United Church of Christ, which the Little Home Church is part of, our denomination, has the phrase, God is still speaking, comma. God is still speaking. I hope you'll answer those questions after some prayerful quiet time. Today I want to close with a prayer by theologian and mystic Howard Thurman. He lived 81 years, 1900 to 1981. He was a confidant to Martin Luther King Jr. He held very prestigious positions in major churches around the country. And in the 60s and 70s started a new church and a new way of worship in San Francisco. We talked about him just a few weeks ago. Yet later in his life, he prayed this prayer for the courage and ability to stay renewed over the course of his life. And this was his prayer, and this would be my prayer for us today. Thurman penned these words. The old song of my spirit has wearied itself out. It has long ago been learned by heart, so that now it repeats itself over and over, bringing no added joy to my days or lift to my spirit. It is a good song, measured to a rhythm to which I am bound by ties of habit and timidity of mind. The words belong to old experiences, which once sprang fresh as water from a mountain crevice fed by melting snows. But my life has passed beyond to other levels where the old song is meaningless. I demand of the old song that it meet the need of present urgencies. Also, I know that the work of the old song, perfect in its place, is not for the new demand. I will sing a new song. As difficult as it is, I must learn the new song that is capable of meeting the new need. I must fashion new words born of all the new growth of my life, my mind, and my spirit. I must prepare for new melodies that have never been mine before, that all that is within me may lift my voice unto God. How I love the old familiarity of the wearied melody. How I shrink from the harsh discords of the new untried harmonies. Teach me, my Father, that I might learn with the abandonment and enthusiasm of Jesus, the fresh new accent, the untried melody, to meet the need of the untried morrow. Thus I may rejoice with each new day and delight my spirit in each fresh unfolding. I will sing this day a new song unto thee, O God. As we move into the future, we're in the midst of a building project across the courtyard, and we have the Wayne Community House coming up within the next year. Let's all ask for God's guidance. Put your requests in your own symbolic earthen jar, whatever that might be. Trust God. Trust each other. And let's start a new song together. Amen.
This is our time in the worship service where we actively and intentionally take part in the support of the ministry of Christ. If you are a member of Little Home Church, we encourage you to continue your pledges and financial support. And if you are visiting with us today, we welcome your gifts as well. You may donate by cash, check, Venmo, PayPal. The QR codes for Venmo and PayPal are listed in the bulletin, and I'll also draw your attention to these cards that are in each pew. The codes are on the back of the card, and for those who participate electronically to the church, this is an opportunity for you to participate as well in the collection. For those of you who may be watching on YouTube, later in the week, this information will be on the screen at the close of the service. Please join me in the offertory prayer. We are invited to offer resources, time, abilities, compassion, in a tangible expression of our hope for the future for ourselves, this community of faith, and many others near and far away. Be generous, my friends, with your trust in the future. God, we have received hope. You give time. We have received hope. We give another the church. We have received hope. We offer these gifts that they may become the change or simply the promise of change among those who need this clear image that they are not abandoned. Amen. Will the
Again, I encourage you to just gather outside, spend some time with each other. I think Mary even said you can take a gander at the rummage sale if you wish as well. Receive the benediction. May you be blessed as Jeremiah, with a word of God whisper or a tap on the shoulder when you're waiting, a glimpse of freedom when you are confined, a friend to show you the way forward, an earthen jar of God's love in which your signature is the most precious thing in it. May the God in you, the divine image to which you are made, see the God in me and all of the wonderful souls that will cross our paths in the days that lie ahead. Amen.